please rise?
Fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him,
who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Reading from the book of Job. Job answered Bildad the Shuhite and said, "Oh, would that my words were written down. Would that they were inscribed in a record, that with an iron chisel and with lead they were cut in the rock forever. But as for me, I know that my vindicator lives, and that he will at last stand forth upon the dust. Whom I myself shall see, my own eyes, none another's, shall behold him. And from my flesh I shall see God. My inmost being is consumed with longing." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
Whom should I fear? The Lord is my life's refuge. Of whom should I be afraid? The Lord is my light and my salvation. One thing I ask of the Lord, this I seek, to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, that I may gaze on the loveliness of the Lord and contemplate his temple.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
Hear, O Lord, the sound of my call. Have pity on me and answer me. Your presence, O Lord, I seek. Hide not your face from me.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
I believe that I shall see the bounty of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord with courage, be stout-hearted, and wait for the Lord.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. For Christ, while we were still helpless, died at the appointed time for the ungodly. Indeed, only with difficulty does one die for a just person, though perhaps for a good person, one might even find courage to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. How much more then, since we are now justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from the wrath? Indeed, if we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son. How much more, once reconciled, will we be saved by his life? Not only that, but we also boast of God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus answered, "I give praise to you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for although you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned, you have revealed them to the childlike. Yes, Father, such has been your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, And no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves. For my yoke is easy, and my burden light. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
On behalf of all the parishioners of St. Cecilia here in Belle, I wish to express my condolences to the family of Ed. I'm sorry for your loss. I think he had already moved away before I had moved here, so I never met him, but I think he is known in the community. And so certainly we're grateful that you came back here for the funeral so that we can share with you and support you in your sorrow, and also in sharing memories of your dad and grandpa. In the Second Vatican Council, there's a passage that was quoted very frequently by St. John Paul II, the great Polish Pope of some of our lifetime, and he would quote so often, "It is only in the mystery of the Word made flesh that the mystery of man truly becomes He's saying it's only when we look at the mystery of who Jesus is that we really understand ourselves. That Jesus is the light that illuminates what is hidden. He illuminates what's hidden within God. He also illuminates what's hidden within us. Sometimes we get defined by what we like or what we do. Maybe we don't think we're getting defined by it, but it's kind of a way that, you know, when we have a common interest or when we know that someone really likes something, we maybe see some aspect of their personality. We see that they enjoyed it, that they were happy when they did that. And we like how that made them feel good. Also, through some of these activities, we might have had a time spent with them. Doing this, I had a really good time with Grandpa. I had this good time with Dad. But it's not the totality of their person that's revealed in that activity. A human person has a great depth. And as a person goes through life and ages, I think we begin to see, you know, when you're a little kid, being the same age as someone is super important. You know, they're a year older than me, I can't associate with them. They're a year younger than me, I don't want anything to do with them. But then you get out of college and it doesn't matter if someone's 10 years older than you. And I think the later in life you get, there becomes this perspective of our common brotherhood and sisterhood in the human race, that we're all human beings and we're just at different stages. And, you know, there's the struggles of the 5-year-old, there's the struggle of the 30-year-old, there's the struggle of the 60-year-old, and there's the struggle of the 90-year-old. And the more union we have with one another, the more depth that we have in our relationships, the more understanding there is. So sometimes a funeral can be seen as kind of just a, I don't know what most people think of a funeral as. I know that it bothers me if it's seen as kind of just a surface level thing, rather than going to the depth. What was at the core of this person? What great dignity did they have? And to whom are we giving them now that they're departed from this world? And so we can learn a lot about the depth of a human being by just studying that person, by being attentive to them, by listening to them, by talking with them. But we do not know the full depths of the human soul until we see that person in relation to Jesus Christ. So first of all, each and every one of us, including Ed, are absolutely and completely unique. There is nobody else just like us. You know, we might look at a snowflake and think that that's marvelous, but that's just some stupid snowflake that's going to dissolve with the sun. It's like you and I are far more intricate than the snowflake, far more unique, far more individual, and we also don't dissolve with the sun. We may die, but we have an eternal soul. We have a body that will be united with that soul for eternity. And so there's far more to us than that. There's a far greater dignity. And so our being comes about from God Himself. He creates us. He wants us to exist, and so we come to exist. Our parents are cooperators in that creative act. but it is God himself who desires us to be, no matter in what way we came to be, whether our family was in perfect shape and everything was good and happy, or if there was major struggles in the way that we came into the world. It doesn't matter, that it is God himself who wanted us to exist and wants us to stay in existence. The next thing that we receive from God himself is redemption. That, you know, when we look out at the world, we see good things, we see plenty of good, but we also see an awful lot of brokenness, and we see it in ourselves. And all of this brokenness is a result of sin. We weren't created broken, we were created perfectly healthy with no problems at all. And it's on account of Adam and Eve's disobedience that we inherit sin, just like a birth defect or some kind of a genetic disorder. And we also know that, I hope we know, that we cause some of the brokenness in the world. That it's our own sin that we choose to do that leads to so many other problems in the world. And because of this, we need a redeemer. We need to be saved. Death itself is a result of sin. Sickness is a result of sin. Every form of evil, whether it be a spiritual evil or a physical evil, is a result of sin. And we need to be saved from that. And that's what Jesus gives us. That's what his death on the cross brought about. And so this great dignity leads to the ability for a very intense suffering. A human being can suffer in a way that a dog can't. I know we think the dog has very expressive eyes, but the dog is just feeling bad, whereas the human being has a sense of this eternal consequences of his suffering and can actually think about it. Not just feel bad, but also think about feeling bad. This act of Jesus, of becoming one of us, of taking on our human existence, you know, he's God, he's not capable of dying, he is incapable of suffering, and yet, to be one with us, he took on our human suffering, our human nature, our human finitude, or what's an understandable word for finitude, our limitedness, and in order to bring us into his divine perfection, to restore us to that life that we had in the beginning. So ultimately, the purpose of a human being, the deepest part of our existence, is to love and to be loved. Why did God create us? Not so that we can do some work for him. He's perfectly capable of doing his own work. It's ultimately the same reason that any of you that have children have those children. It's because you love them. It's not complex. It is complex in a certain sense, but it's why do you have kids? Because you love them. Not so they can help out on the farm or do your dishes for you. If they can do that, that's good, but that's not the reason. They're created for love. And for us to be completely human, we have to be receivers of love and givers of love. We're created out of love and we're created for love. And that's what Jesus reveals in us. He reveals to us how much the Father loves us, how much the Holy Spirit loves us, how much he loves us by laying down his life for us. We saw that in the scriptures, that it's difficult to die for a good man, and it's impossible to die for someone bad. And what St. Paul is saying with that is, we were bad, and Jesus died for us. We were sinners, we caused all this suffering, and Jesus died for us out of love. And our response is to say thank you, and to love him in return. Our full dignity and the depths of our humanity can only be satisfied when we're in union with God himself. Just mere human love is not enough for us. Human love gives us like an entry point into divine love. It's through, sometimes through the love of our parents that we come to know the love of God. They show us what self-sacrificial loves look like, so we start to understand it. And then when we realize what God himself did for us, what Jesus did for us, we understand it more deeply. What Jesus did. So our parents and those who love us on a human level can help us to realize this divine level, but it's a more profound form of love. And that's what our longing for heaven is. We saw that in the book of Job. Job was an Old Testament figure who went through some horrible, horrible sufferings. And in the end of it, he basically says, I trust in God's promise of heaven. I trust in the goodness that he wants to give to me. Heaven is not just the ending of the sufferings of this present life. Like, to really be happy as a human being, it's not good enough just to not suffer. I think we know this from our experience of the last year. that in isolation, we were lacking union with others. That's what made us sad. That's what made us depressed. It wasn't that we were sick necessarily, like the isolation was to keep us from getting sick, right? But the isolation itself was almost a form of sickness, because we need to be in communion with others. And so we've probably experienced some element of isolation from others, and it's painful. Imagine isolation from God, that this is a deeper form of love, a more profound form of love, of which if we really look deep in our core of our being, without it, we are absolutely desperate. We are completely empty and without meaning. And so heaven is this perfect union with God. It's not, yes, all forms of evil are gone. Sickness, pain, death, the injustices that are caused to us and that we cause to others, those are gone. Absolutely, it will be good in that way. But it's even better because of the union with God that is perfect. So coming to a Christian or Catholic funeral mass, I hope is not seen as something that's, you know, dour and, you know, just completely sad and nothing happy and good. Obviously, you know, we should cry when we lose someone we love. That's like, the pain of separation is real and we love them, so we should cry. But the Christian funeral is deeply optimistic. It acknowledges the deep dignity of the human person, that there is a unique and irrepeatable person here whom we desire to see again in heaven. That the bonds that we had here on earth are not broken through death. We hear that in the prayers of the Mass. And it's also founded upon hope of eternal happiness. Now, there's a difference between Christian hope and utopianism. Utopia is a place that cannot exist. And various utopias are seen as an earthly place where everything is perfect, is brought about by political or technological advances. And you and I are technically probably living in some kind of a utopia right now, where we have a phone that's more capable than a computer of 10 years ago. But it's really not that great. I'm not saying that everything's bad today, but I don't think we're living in heaven yet. So these are false promises of complete happiness. There's no way upon this earth that any of these things are going to take care of the deepest longings of our soul. But the hope that we have in heaven is founded upon an absolute promise made by God Himself, one who can neither deceive nor be deceived, one who is all-powerful, all-knowing, one who has always existed, one who always will exist. And so there's a deep consolation that we can have through the funeral mass, through the prayers, through our entrustment of our deceased relative and friend to the hands of God, that what we hope for is something that is absolutely possible. It is absolutely going to happen. We must just be faithful to it. We must choose to follow Christ and to desire that union with Him here on earth so that we may have it in eternity. So I'd encourage you to continue to pray for Ed. That's what we're doing right now. That's also certainly one of the purposes of the funeral mass. If you've ever been to a funeral here before, you've heard me say this because I say it every single time because I don't know another way of saying it. But if I died tonight, I don't think I'd go straight to heaven. You don't know all the sins on my soul. I don't know all the sins on your soul. But I'm pretty sure we've committed a few sins. We're not perfect in love yet. And heaven is only for those who are perfect in love. And so there has to be a purification. And as Catholics, we believe that it's called purgatory. It's this mercy of God that He, after the point of our death, if we're not yet perfect in love, if there's still the effects of sin on our soul, that He purifies us. That He, it's kind of like, you know, the sufferings that we have in this world, we can offer them as a sacrifice in reparation for our sins, but we don't always. And that can take away some of the effect of our sin. But this is like God's final chance of, like, this is your time to be made completely pure. So I'm pretty darn sure I would spend some time in purgatory. And the way that we help someone in purgatory is by praying for them. On earth we can help ourselves, in purgatory we cannot. And so it's an act of charity, actually, to pray for the repose of the soul of our faithful departed. And another way of saying it is simply that they're depending upon our prayers for us, and that's what we do at the funeral. Would encourage you to continue to do that through the following year and the following years. And one of the traditional ways of praying for the dead is to offer masses for them too. And so to ask the priest, hey, would you say a mass for my dad? This is his name. also you can have your own intention every time you go to Mass. You don't have to ask the priest to have it as his intention. You can just say, when I go to Mass, I'm offering this for Ed. And so I encourage you to do that. I guess we won't know what effect it has until we get to the other side. So I'm going on the side of being generous and hope that you do as well. Brothers and sisters, please stand. Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to him. In baptism, Ed received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Our brother Ed was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Many friends and members of our families have gone before us and await the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly these sins against your love, and gather them to the eternal kingdom of peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of Ed, seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that comes from grief. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother Ed. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your Son's coming. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people, whose lives are purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Please join in singing number 674 in the Word and Psalm book, Here I Am, Lord, 674.
servant had. We beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life has changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. So with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of
your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Cecilia, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and John, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Ed, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever.
Now mercy be on
Catholics, we believe that communion is a sign of our common belief. And so we also understand there's divisions between different Christian denominations, and we ask that we work to heal that division, but we don't do it through shared communion. So if you're not Catholic, please don't receive communion, but you can always put your hands over your cross over your chest, and I will give you a blessing.
Please join in our communion hymn number 588, One Bread, One Body, 588.
Bye. resolution of condolence from the Drake Council, 5856, and the Monsignor O'Neill, 4th degree, Assembly, 1549, Harvard. In memory of Brother Edward White, whereas it hath pleased Almighty God in his infinite wisdom, call from our midst our beloved brother, who departed this life, August 18, 2021. And whereby his death, our council and assembly have sustained the loss of an exemplary Catholic gentleman and worthy Knight of Columbus. Therefore, be it resolved that our departed brother be remembered daily in a special mass offered for the repose of the souls of all deceased brother knights at St. Mary's Church, the birthplace of our order in New Haven, Connecticut. Be it further resolved that while we bow in submission to the will of our Heavenly Father, we mourn the loss of our brother who has been taken from us. And be it further resolved that this testimonial of condolence, duly signed and sealed, be offered to the family of the departed Brother Knight as an expression of our heartfelt sympathy.
Please stand. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, mercifully grant that strengthened by it, our brother Ed may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Immediately following the funeral mass, we will have lunch in the basement of the church. After that, we'll go to the cemetery in Warren for the burial of both Ed and Shirley. So please take part in whatever parts of it you are able to. And look forward to family members. I haven't met all of you yet, so I'd like to meet you sometime this afternoon. So tell me who you are.
Please join in singing number 30 on page 36, the Song of Farewell.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Now we'll begin our song of farewell.
Thank you.
him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Ed in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In peace, let us take our brother to his place of rest. May the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem.
Our closing hymn is number 733, On Eagle's Wings, 733.
Oh,
truly exceeding hearts. We truly exceeding hearts.